Everybody, good morning.
Good morning.
Thank God I'm back.
Amen.
God is faithful.
Yes, He is.
He is so faithful. Amen. Father, we just thank you for our time together today for this faith and healing class. We submit ourselves to just hear from you, to hear your will for our lives with this word. And Father, when we hear it, we know that when we put our faith in it, our life is going to change. The word will go forth with power, anointing, clarity, and understanding. Thank you that our faith will be increased. Satan, you're defeated. Every one of your plans is canceled in Jesus' name. And Holy Spirit, we exalt the word of God in this place. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Give God a clap off praise if you're in agreement. Amen. It's good to be back. Been off several weeks. We just thank God for his faithfulness. Amen. Yes. We thank him for his faithfulness. His word is true. And if we put our faith in it and keep our faith in it, it'll be revealed through our own lives.
Yes.
God wants us to know it. The key to our life is believing, putting our faith, and living and experiencing the Word of God. And we can't be moved by what we see. We cannot be moved by what we see. Amen. Well, we're going to go to Matthew 8, beginning at verse 1, verses 1 through 3 in the New King James. And the Lord said, I want you to talk about my will today. Talk about my will today. So in Matthew 8, beginning at verse 1, it said, when he had come down from the mountain, that's referring to Jesus, great multitudes followed him. And behold, a leper came and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if you are what?
Willing.
If you're willing, you can make me clean. Mm-hmm. And then Jesus put out his hand and touched him, saying, I am willing, be cleansed. And immediately, his leprosy was cleansed. This is a very interesting passage of scripture, and it's really relevant today because so many people question what God's will is concerning situations that they face in their life. Now, this leper, when he approached the Lord, you understand that a leper back in Jesus' day was a person that was not even allowed to live with the general population. The reason they weren't allowed to live with the general population is because leprosy was a contagious disease. And so the lepers were isolated to colonies and camps and weren't allowed to mingle with the general population so that the disease wouldn't spread. It kind of sounds like COVID.
Amen.
But here's the thing. The leper approached Jesus. He approached Jesus. Even though he knew the law, he approached Jesus. Why did he approach him? He approached Jesus because he knew that Jesus had the power to heal. He knew that Jesus had the power to heal. How many of you in here today know that Jesus has the power to heal you? I know it. Amen. I was sharing a little bit Sunday, this experience that I went through, and in the heat of it, at the beginning of it, when my consciousness came back, I wasn't able to talk, but I could hear, and I heard all these people with saying all these negative things about my body, saying what my body had experienced. I mean, they calling one thing right after another. And I can hear it, but I couldn't say anything. But in my spirit,
yes.
I want you to know, I knew that Jesus had the power to heal me. Are you hearing me? They're saying this, they're saying that, but in my spirit, I knew that Jesus, not only did he have the power to heal me, that my body would be restored.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And I shared Sunday, I had zero fear.
Zero.
I had absolutely no fear at all. I don't care what y'all are saying. I know Jesus has power. I know the word of God is full of power. I know the word of God works. And I know the word of God. Amen. I know the word of God. And so I had to focus. Couldn't say anything, but in my mind I could focus. I'm healed by the stripes of Jesus. Jesus has the power to heal my body. That leper knew, he knew that Jesus had the power to heal him. Even though he knew Jesus had the power to heal him, he had another question that so many people have in their mind today. He said in verse 2, at the end of verse 2, he said, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. And so what he's doing is he's making a declaration concerning his faith in the power of Jesus. But then the question that he had is, do you want to heal me? And that's a question so many people have today. The question is, what is God's will for me in the situations and circumstances that I'm facing in my life? The leper said, if you are willing, you can heal me. And so the question was, I know you have the power, but do you want me to be healed? And, you know, because of so much erroneous teaching throughout the body of Christ, many Christians still have that question right now. When they face sickness and disease in their body, they are not sure whether God wants to heal them. They're not sure whether God wants to make them well. Amen? And I'm just here to tell you that, you know, religion has brought that teaching into the church. Amen? There are some foundational Christian teachings that religion, Christian faiths have been based on that say that everything that happens is the will of God. Everything that happens is the will of God. That is the belief of many Christians today. And it's based on the premise that if the thing took place, evidently God permitted it to. Right? If it took place, God permitted it to. And this teaching is pervasive throughout most Christian denominations. If it happens, God permitted it. And so, you know, if that's true, you know, if that teaching is true, then what's the point of praying?
Right.
If that's true, why did Jesus teach us to pray about certain things? If everything that takes place is the permissive will of God, what's the point of prayer? Because, you know, God's going to do what he's going to do. And he's going to permit what he's going to permit. And there's nothing we can do about it. That's why the world is so confused. The world is very confused today, particularly concerning God. Because the world sees all of the different things, negative things going on. These are not believers. These are not people who believe in God. They don't believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And all they see are the situations that are taking place before their eyes, and they're negative. And the question is, why is God allowing this to happen?
Come on.
They believe that God is participating in it. Indirectly, they're assuming that it is God's will, that he is actually participating in it. This leper wasn't sure. He wasn't sure whether Jesus would be willing to heal him.
Come on.
And so he asked him. He said, if you're willing, you can. And so what he was literally saying is, do you want to heal somebody like me?
Yeah.
Look at the response of Jesus. I love it. Verse 3, Jesus didn't even say anything right away, did he? Then Jesus put out his hand and touched him. Woo, that's powerful. What did you just ask me, leper? You just said, if I'm willing, I can heal you. I'm going to show you how willing I am. I'm going to show you how willing I am. Not only am I not afraid of your disease, I'm going to put my hand on you.
Yes, yes.
Are y'all hearing me?
Yes.
He answered the question before he even said a word. It says he touched him. Then he said, look at what he said. I am willing. Be cleansed. Ooh, that's good news. That is such great news. And guess what it did? It destroyed the religious barriers between this man receiving his healing or remaining a leper the rest of his life. Because the religious law says you don't touch a leper. And Jesus wanted to demonstrate the love of God and the will of God concerning our lives. How many of you understand that the leper, this example of this leper, is good news for us?
Yes.
It's good news for us. Because what Jesus does for one, in principle, he'll do for everyone else. I'm going to touch on that a little bit later this morning. And so it's good news for us to see when the man said, if you're willing, you can heal me. It's good news for us to see that Jesus was absolutely willing to heal him. Oh, that's good news.
Amen.
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 The will of God really isn't complicated. It is simply what God desires to take place and what God desires to have done. That's the will of God. What he desires to take place, what he desires to have done. That's what the will of God is. What is his desire for us? Now, there are some misconceptions concerning the will of God. There are. Because people believe that whatever God's will is, it has to come to pass. People believe that. If God wills it, if God wants something, it has to come to pass. Right? And that's a misconception.
Yes.
It is. It's a misconception that if God wants something to happen, it will happen. And, you know, you can see where, you know, people would assume that. Because when you look at the Word of God, it appears that when God wants something to take place, it can occur. He has the power to make it happen. He has the power to bring to pass anything that he wants. Are y'all with me?
Yes.
God has the power to produce his will. Anything that he wants, he literally has the power to make it come into existence. And so the natural assumption is if he has the power to make it come into existence, if God wants it, he'll get it. But that's not true. The will of God is not automatically fulfilled. Now, that's very important in the area of faith, okay? It's very important to understand this principle in the area of faith because the will of God, even though he has the power to produce it, it does not automatically occur. So what that means is if it is the will of God for everyone to be healed, we cannot assume that everyone will be. Are y'all with me?
Yes. Yes.
Even though it's his will, even though I believe with every fiber of my being that God does not want one person on this planet sick.
Amen. 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 Amen.
I believe it. Not one sick. I believe that's his will. However, the will of God is not automatic. How many of you know every person on the earth isn't healed? Got it? So what's up with that? God, you don't want anyone sick, yet on the earth there are people who are experiencing sickness in their body. You know, I know there, I guarantee you, there's some folks that was looking at me cross-eyed, thinking about me cross-eyed. Y'all know what I mean by that. Looking at me funny or thinking about me funny because I'm up here teaching faith. I'm a faith teacher.
Yes,
right. Excuse me. Good thing you 6 feet. Because if you was 3, you'd be getting baptized. So people assume, they assume if it's the will of God, it automatically take place. You know, so people looking at me like, you teaching all that faith stuff. What's up with you? What's up with you? And I shared a little bit on that Sunday. The word of God, Jesus never said that everybody that believes in him and believes in his word wouldn't face challenges in their life. As a matter of fact, the word of God says just the opposite. Psalm says many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them from all of them. And then Jesus said in John 16 and 33, he said, in this world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. Be of good cheer. He said, I've overcome the world. So what was he saying? You're going to face some challenges, even though you're my son, even though you're my daughter, God is saying. You'll face challenges. You may even get attacked with symptoms of sickness against your body. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Hallelujah. And so folks are probably saying, well, what's up with you, preacher? Mr. Faith preacher? What you doing in the hospital for 10 days? Guess what? I was asking the same question. What am I doing in the hospital for 10 days? I'm telling y'all, that place is the lion's den. Ooh-wee. I mean, forget resting, because every hour somebody coming to poke, stick. But here's what I mean by that. Yeah, I ask myself the question, what the heck am I doing up in here for 10 days? And God kept saying to me, he says, I'm your healer. I'm your healer, because they coming in every 15 minutes. I told you Sunday, the first 3 days, they said, what's your name? Like, I don't know my name. What's your name and birthday? Cedric Oliver, 1656, thank you very much. What month is it at the time? It's August. Where are you? Told them where I was at, because they think I don't know where I'm at. This stuff, my experience that I went through, they said, no, he can't be thinking straight. He can't. It just everything they asked me. Jesus. Holy Spirit, boom, 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 boom. But thank God he delivered me from that lion's den. You better, I'm going to say this to you. I pray you never have to experience it.
Amen.
Or any of your loved ones. That's my prayer for you. But I will tell you this, you better have word in you. You better get built up in the word of God during the good time.
Amen.
You better get full of the word of God in your spirit and then not just be head level. You better know that you know that you know what you say you believe.
Amen.
Are you hearing me?
Yes.
You better know that you know that you know what you believe. Because that is a place that is 100% driven by facts. And all they do is repeat the facts. They give you what they see over and over and over again. It was funny. It was funny. The Sunday before I got out of there, I was looking at the server. This guy comes in real early in the morning. I'm going to be your nurse today. And some, I had a check in my spirit when he said it. I'm going to be your nurse today, because he's pushing his computer in and plopping his behind down like he's going to be in my room for the next hour. And he sits down and starts going through a laundry list of symptoms, asking me if I'm experiencing them. I'm like, this ain't nothing but the devil. I've been up in here 9 days. They have asked me every question that needs to be asked by now. I certainly don't need you sitting up in here asking me these questions again. But he called himself being thorough. And then, so then he did this little test on me. And I guess the results weren't what they should have been. And instead of him being a pro and not saying anything, he said, "Whoa, this is high." I'm like, excuse me. I thought they taught y'all better than this. My whole point is, you better know that you know that you know what you believe. You better know that the word, you better know the will of God concerning you being healed. You better know it. Amen. You better know that you know that you know it. Because that devil, when I told Dr. J about that dude, she said, "Devil just sent him to vex you." And I said, "Well, he's a liar." Amen. Because I'm here today.
Amen.
Amen. Come on, let's give God praise. So the will of God is not automatically fulfilled. So don't think that. Okay. Just because it's his will for everyone to be healed, everyone doesn't experience it right away. Some people never experience healing. Unfortunately, there are believers. Stay with me now. This is very important for us today. There are believers in the Lord Jesus Christ who have been taught the word of God on healing, and some didn't experience it. The good news is they went to be with Jesus.
Yes.
Now, that's good news for believers. We never lose. Amen. But when that occurs, people like, what's up with that? Because that person went to church. That's the person that quote the word. So I'm just here to tell you, the will of God is not automatically fulfilled. There must be something that activates the will of God being fulfilled in your life. And y'all know what that is. Y'all said that like, what is it?
Your faith.
Your
faith.
Faith. It is your faith that activates the will of God and the power of his will to be released in your life. It is your
faith.
It is your extreme confidence and knowing that the word of God is true. That's what triggers the will of God being fulfilled in your life. And that's why some folks who are saved have gone to be with the Lord. Because, see, I've dealt with people, several, who transitioned to be with the Lord. And while they were going through their test and trial, and we'd go and visit them, you know, "I'm standing on the word. I believe it's true." And you know, and I believe in their mind they really did. But then, you know, you come back and you hear the report from the family. And I've heard the family say, "Mama said she was tired."
Yes.
Mm-hmm. "Mama said she was tired and Mama said she was ready to
That's
go."
Right. That's right.
You know, are y'all with me?
Sure. Yes.
I'm teaching you about the will of God. Yes. It can be misinterpreted. That's why I'm teaching you this. Yes. It can be misinterpreted. Interpreted. So, on one hand, the person is saying, "I'm standing on the word," but on the other hand, because I'm going to tell you something, some attacks wear your body and your mind and your emotions. It wears you down. It wears you down. And only those who say, "I'm standing no matter how I feel, I'm keeping my eyes on the word. I'm not taking my eyes off of the word. I'm not allowing interruptions in my thought life to cause me to shift my focus from what God has promised and has said is his will for my life. I'm keeping my eyes on it." Are y'all hearing me? I am healed. And not only I was healed by the stripes of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's all I'm going to say. That's all I'm going to believe. And that's all I'm going to focus on. But nothing. I'm not looking to my left or my right. I'm not looking to the left or my right. I'm staying focused on the will and the word of God until I see and experience what he's promised me.
Amen.
Not backing off. Come on and give God praise.
Hallelujah.
That's how the will. That's how the will gets activated. Amen.
Amen.
If you entertain other thoughts, you'll get into what's called the wave mode. You'll be going back and forth in your mind. And in the book of James said, let not that man think he shall receive anything from God. Amen. Everybody say the will of God.
The will of God
is not automatic.
It's not automatic.
And you know, the proof of this is, it really is, excuse me, you go to the word of God, go to 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, New King James, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. This really brings this point home concerning the will of God, whether or not the will of God is automatically fulfilled. Now, everybody, you know, I may not get to it today, but I do want to say this, and you need to write this somewhere down in your notes or type it somewhere. The will of God for every one of us is good.
Amen.
Yes. You need to write that down.
Yes.
The will of God for every one of us is good. Amen. God doesn't want any darkness in your life.
Yes.
None. That's his will for us. That's good right there.
Yes.
Man, you just park right there for a minute. God does not want any darkness to inhabit or invade our life.
Yes.
His will for us is only good. Not just good, only good. Amen.
Yes.
That's his will for us. Nothing negative, nothing dark. Amen.
Amen.
Only good.
Only good.
And so if darkness comes, if negative comes, we know that we know that we know that this is not from God.
Amen.
And this is not his will. And so we get in resist mode. We get in resist mode right away.
Yeah.
If it's darkness, even if the shade is coming, it ain't completely dark yet. If it's starting to get a little overcast, we get in resist mode because God's will for me is only good.
Yeah.
Only good, get this, all the time.
Yeah.
His will for me is only good. All the time. No lapses. No moments of shifting from good. His will for me is good. Anything other than good is darkness. And God is light. And in him there is no darkness at all. Amen. That's his will for me. It's only good all the time. Amen. We just studying just so that you're armed when people may come to you and try to counter what you know the truth to be. And they'll come to you and they'll say, well, if he's so good, why didn't it go so good in this situation? Well, you're going to have an answer for them. You're going to tell them just because God wills a thing doesn't mean it automatically comes to pass. There's things that have to take place to activate it. So you're in 2 Peter 3? This is just bearing the truth out in this principle that the will of God is not automatic. They said the Lord is not slack concerning his promise as some count slackness. That word slack literally means slow in fulfilling his promise. But is long-suffering towards us, not what?
Willing.
Not willing. What?
That any
should perish. That what?
All.
Should what?
Come to repentance.
So what is the will of God? What's the will of God?
That all should be saved.
That how many?
All.
Oh. Mm-hmm. That's God's
will.
Will. That is the will of God. And so his will is that none should perish and that all should come to repentance. So the skeptic would say, well, if that's his will, then everybody has to be saved. And some folks have got into some erroneous doctrine and started teaching some erroneous stuff based on the assumption that God's will is automatically fulfilled. This folks teaching folks that everybody's going to be saved. Regardless. This folks teaching that. Are y'all hearing me? And they are basing it on a scripture. Because if it's God's will, then God's will is always fulfilled. Well, they didn't read the whole book. Because all they needed to do was go to Revelation 20. Why don't we turn there? Why don't we turn there? Amen. Is your spirit being built up?
Yes.
Are you learning something today?
Yes.
Amen. Is this time well spent?
Yes.
Y'all online, hit me with a comment. Let me know that it's time well spent.
Amen.
Amen. So is his will, he not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Then we go to Revelation 20, beginning at verse 13. And it ain't funny. Is that the sea gave up the dead who were in it. And death and Hades is another word for hell, delivered up the dead who were in them. Hades is like the holding place for sinners and unbelievers until the very end of time. They don't immediately go to the lake of fire, they go to Hades. All right, now it's still a place of torment. We know it's a place of torment because when Jesus talked about the rich man and Lazarus, he said that Lazarus went into Abraham's bosom, but the rich man was tormented. He wasn't in a lake of fire, but he was tormented. He was so tormented, he says, just let Lazarus dip his finger in some water and put it on my tongue. It's torment.
Right.
All right? So Hades is a holding place. But it said at this point now in Revelations 20 and 13, Hades gave up the dead who were in them. It said, and they were judged, each one according to his works. Then look at this. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. Look at verse 15. And what?
Anyone,
which means there was someone.
Right. Yes. Right.
Got it?
Yes.
Anyone means there was someone.
That's right.
All right? But what do we read in 2 Peter? It is not, he's not willing that any should perish. But now we read here in 15, anyone who was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. So here is a clear case. After knowing God's will that none should perish, here is a clear case in the Word that shows us just because God wills it, it doesn't mean it's going to happen or be fulfilled for everyone. Are y'all with me? So now we ask ourselves, how did this happen? How is it for God to be willing to do something and it not happen? Well, the Word is very clear. You know, the book of Romans chapter 10 said, in beginning of verse 8, here's why everybody didn't make it. Romans 10 and 8. You remember I said that in order for God's will to be fulfilled, there must be something that activates it?
Yes.
All right? Well, we're going to look at the activator that could have prevented those folks from going into the lake of fire. They didn't have to go. Amen? All right, what's the activator? Look at Romans 10. Y'all with me?
Yes. Absolutely.
We good?
Yes.
All right. It says in verse 8, Romans 10, New King James. What does it say? The word is near you. So everybody that goes into the lake of fire, they won't have an argument. They won't be able to go to God and say, you were so far away from me. No. The word is near you. The word was close to you. In your mouth. And in your heart. That is the word of what?
Faith.
Which we preach. What could have changed these folks who got thrown to the lake of fire position? Faith. Verse 9. All you had to do, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, if you confess with your mouth, you didn't even have to make a promise to me that you'd never make another mistake in your life. I just needed you to have put your faith in my son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And I need you to not just think he's the Son of God. I needed you to confess with your mouth. That's a powerful principle. Because we're reading about salvation, but the same principle applies to my healing. The same principle here. I can't just know the word says I'm healed. I got to confess with my mouth. I am healed by the stripes of Jesus. I got to open my mouth. Amen. I'm telling you, this time that we're living in now, we better start using our mouth. We better start using our mouth. We better start saying, every need in my life is met. Every need is supplied in Jesus' name. I am healed by the stripes of Jesus. And you got to get bold. I believe God wants us to get to a point where we say, I can't get sick. I can't get sick. Am I taking you too far? Do I need to bring you back to the shallow end? Huh? We got to start confessing with our mouths. I am rich. There is no lack in my life. I can't live in lack. Lack is darkness. Lack is in light. I can't live in lack. I can't live in sickness. Sickness is darkness. God is light. I can't be sick in the name of Jesus. Confess with our
mouth.
You online, speak it. Because here we go. Why'd he end up in the lake? If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, verse 9, and Romans 10 and 9, and believe in your heart. So it's not enough to just believe in my heart. Yes. Let that soak. I know Jesus is my, you ain't talking, you talking to yourself. You ain't saying nothing out loud. I know he's my healer. Where you believe that? In my heart. Yeah, that's good. That's good. But you know what Jesus said about the heart? He said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. That's what Jesus said. He said, so don't tell me it's in your heart. I'll know when your heart is full of the word of healing. I'll know when your heart is full of the word of a prosperous and abundant life. I know when you really believe in your heart, because out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth's going to say something. Your mouth's going to say what's in your heart. It's going to come out of your mouth. See, what we don't understand is what activates the will of God to be fulfilled in our life, it is not activated until it comes out of our mouth from my heart. No more being a cool Christian. What do you mean by that, Dr. C? No more being a cool Christian. Just walking around and saying, well, you know what I know. You know that I know. No, 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 no. But I never hear you say. Some people dealing with some things. You ought to be saying, I have the best job in the world. Because the Lord says he would give me the desires of my heart. So I desire this job. And you need to open your mouth and say the job. It activates the will of God when I speak. Are y'all hearing me? I mean, I could take you on a journey here. And Jesus is on that boat. And it's filling up with water. And it's flopping all around. And the disciples are freaking out. Been with Jesus for a long time. But for some reason, all you hear coming out of their mouth, we're going to drown. We're going to die. So they wake Jesus up. Hey, go and wake Jesus up. Come on, this connects. This connects with what I'm teaching you. This connects with confessing with your mouth. What's the activator for the will of God? Not only believe in my heart, but I got to speak it. So they wake Jesus up. They go to the back of the boat and they wake him up. And he gets up. And what does he do? He walks to the front of the boat. And what does he do? Does he stand up there and say, just start talking to himself? I know you, God.
Come on now.
You are my Savior. There's no way you're going to let us drown. Talking to him. Was he saying things to himself?
No.
Did he?
No.
He knew the will of God concerning that trip.
Exactly.
He knew the will of God concerning that trip because before he got in the boat, he said, let's go over to the other side. When he spoke it, that was the will. Are y'all with me? So when he wakes up, he didn't have a silent moment of prayer. Out of the abundance of his heart, I'm supposed to be over there. Something's waiting for me over there. And because I'm supposed to be there, it is the will. I'm going to open my mouth and I'm going to command the wind and the waves. Peace. Be still. He opened his mouth. When he opened his mouth, it did what? What did it do? There it is. What did it do? Activated the will of God. Now, here's what I want you to know. It was not activated until he spoke. If he had not spoken, that boat was going down. I don't know about you. I want all of God's will. Activated in my life. And it's going to require me to speak. Amen. And we ain't just talking. Come on, we ain't just up there rambling. We are speaking the word of God. Amen. Let me finish. Y'all thought I lost place. I know where I'm at. I'm in Romans 10, verse 9. Hallelujah. Isn't God good?
Amen.
Come on and give him a clap off and a praise.
Hallelujah. Amen.
So now here's what I do. I confess with my mouth Jesus is Lord. I'm still dealing with the will of God and always automatically fulfilled. We saw it's his will and none to perish, but then we read what people perish. Well, what caused them to perish? Because they didn't do this. They didn't confess with their mouth that Jesus was Lord. They didn't believe in their heart that God had raised him from the dead. Because if you do that, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God had raised him from the dead, guess what? You'll be saved and the will of God will be activated in your life. And you won't be cast into the lake of fire. You will not perish, but you shall have everlasting life through the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. Now look at verse 10. Look at verse 10 because it's key. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness. And with the mouth,
come on.
Confession is made unto salvation. So I can't have salvation even though I believe unto righteousness. I will not experience salvation until confession is made with my mouth. With my mouth. Y'all catching this?
Yes.
It's a principle. Mm-hmm. It's a principle not just for salvation, but for every promise of God.
Yes.
My heart can receive the word, but it's not activated until I confess I must speak. Are you getting this?
Yes.
See, this war, we're going to have to talk more than ever before. We're going to have to talk more than ever before. Because guess what the sword of the Spirit is? The sword of the Spirit is what?
The word of God.
I need you to catch this. See, because, you know, we're dealing with putting on full armor of God and being able to stand, right, in Ephesians 6. We're talking about putting on that full armor of God and being able to stand. But it says that the sword of the Spirit is what? So my weapon in this faith fight, my weapon in this war, my weapon is the word of God.
Yes.
Now get this. What it literally means is that my weapon in this spiritual warfare is me speaking the word of God. Are y'all hearing me?
Yes.
My weapon in this warfare is me speaking the word of God. When I speak, guess what I'm doing? I'm using my sword. I'm not using my sword knowing the word.
Come on.
I'm not using my weapon knowing the word. I'm using my weapon, speaking. I am healed. That's when I use the sword. I use the sword when I speak. Are you getting it? We got to start.
Speaking
what?
The word of God.
Come on, that's it. We must start speaking the word of God. And let me tell you something. Don't pay attention to folks who say, there you go again.
Come on, Dr. C, say that. Come on.
You know what your response should be? At least I'm going somewhere.
Come on.
There you go again. You right. At least I'm going somewhere. While you stay here criticizing me, you ain't moving. Your problems ain't getting no better. You ain't seeing no breakthrough. You ain't seeing no deliverance. Yes, here I go again. I am healed. I am prosperous. Come on, I live in the light. Hallelujah. We got to speak. My speaking activates the will of God. Not the will of God isn't automatically fulfilled, but I know how to get it fulfilled.
Yes.
Come on, don't we?
Yes.
Come on, we got it.
Yes.
Yeah, it's not always fulfilled because, yep, we saw his will concerning salvation and everybody didn't make, but I know how to get it fulfilled in my life. And now that I know how to get it fulfilled in my life, I'm going to tell somebody else how to get it fulfilled in theirs. I'm not keeping it to myself. Amen?
Amen.
God is good. His will for us is only good. You can know the will of God. Write it down. Type it somewhere. I can know the will of God. You know how, you know, religion messes things up. Because, they've convinced some people that, you know, God really doesn't want to just lay his will out there for everybody to know it. You know, and he wants some of you to dig for it. He wants you to dig hard and, you know, he just really doesn't want you to know what his will is. That's a lie. That's a big lie. God wants you to know his will. He isn't hiding it. He isn't making it difficult for you to know it. He wants you to know it. That's the good news. Isn't that great news? So how do I know the will of God? How do I know the will of God? I was going to end in one spot and God told me to go to another. I'm going to end here today. How do I know the will of God? How do I determine the will of God? Two very basic ways to know the will of God and determine the will. Number one, I can know the will of God by his word. I can know, that didn't sound exciting, did it? Oh, but it's a key. It's a key to a treasure. It's a key to a treasure. I can know the will of God by his word. If I know his word, his word is his will.
Amen.
That's why it's good to come to Faith and Healing and log on. It's good to come to Faith and Healing and log on. It's just good. Because if I know his word, I know his will. Well, where is that in the Bible? John chapter 1, verse 1, New King James. How can I know the will of God? When I know the will of God, I can speak the will of God. When I speak the will of God, it activates his will in my life. I want to know his will. How can I know it? Through his
word.
John 1 and 1. In the beginning was the word. And the word was with God. And the word was God. Let's read that together. 1, 2, 3. In the beginning was the word. And the word was with God. And the word was God. So if I know the word, I know God. And if I know God, I know his will. His word is his will. What does his word say about healing? Ha! Come on. Come on. If I know his word, I know his will. Hallelujah. Because he and his word are the same. It ain't a mystery. It's not a mystery. I got 66 books that are full of the will of God.
Amen.
Come on, if I don't feel like reading every book, I can come to church.
Yeah.
Amen. Come on, I can get some word at church. When I get the word, I'm getting God. When I get God, his will is revealed to me. Glory to God.
Amen.
So yeah, say it is possible. Say that. Say it's possible.
It's possible.
Say not only possible.
Not only possible.
It's easy.
It's easy
for me
to know
the will of God.
Because I have his word.
And I'm going to tell you, our generation is without excuse.
Yeah.
Y'all, when I started preaching and I started pastoring, and Minister Donna will tell you too, she ain't old as me. Don't look at her and think she's old. But she'll tell you, when we used to get ready for messages, we have our Bible. We have our Strongs. We have our Vines. You know, I mean, you got all of these books that you got to go through, y'all. Y'all hear me? I mean, you spend hours. And today, got my phone, pull up a Bible app, put a word in, it'll spit out every scripture. We are without excuse. Nobody in our generation can say I didn't have access to God's will being revealed to my life.
Amen.
It's easy to know the will of God. Here's the key, though. When you get into that word, believe it.
Yes.
You got to see that scripture that you're reading not as words on a page, but God.
Yes.
This word is God. And because it's God, it's his will for me. So I put my faith in it. I believe it. Hallelujah. I can know the will of God. And I don't know how to activate it. So the will of God is determined by the word of God. And then the second point is determined by looking at the life of Jesus. Get into the Gospels and look at how Jesus dealt with all the situations he faced. The sickness. See, he healed every sickness. He healed every disease. There were instances in the Word of God say, well, everybody got healed. And Jesus didn't have small crowds following him. Everybody got healed. So if he healed everybody then, that must be the will of God. Guess what? He's the same. Yesterday, today, and forevermore. He's healing everybody. Look at the life of Jesus. How did he deal with demonic spirits? How did he deal with the devil? See, Jesus said, I came, get this, to do the will of my Father. That's what he said in his word. I came to do the will of my Father. So when I look at how Jesus dealt with things, it reveals God's will for that type of situation in my life. Are y'all hearing me? I want us to be a church that just lives, walks, experiences the will of God in our life. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
God, praise for the word today.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen, amen, amen. Can we share? Some folks share. Can we have some folks share what you got today out of the word of God? Amen, amen. If ain't a, yes. This is my faith that activates the word and the will of God. Yeah. Anyone else? All right. Y'all going to insult me? All right. Yvette?
Okay. The will of God for
Will of God for us is only good. Yes. Let me hear you, brother. Yell out. Sword of the Spirit. Okay. Oh, yeah. I saw that movie. Yeah, yeah. Amen. Sword of the Spirit is the word of God. You're talking about that movie that came out where the woman's son fell through the ice, but she stood on the word of God. Right. Healing came to that boy. Yes. Supernaturally brought back to life. You got to open up your mouth and speak the word of God. Yes. Amen. Yep, you got to believe it first. Amen. That's it. You got to believe it first. And then once you believe, we speak. Amen. His word is his will. Yes. We are without excuse. Can't nobody in this generation say, I didn't have access to know the will of God. Amen. Let's give God praise again. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Martha? Yes.
Oh, you made me. I was going to say that whatever's in your heart in abundance is going to come out of your mouth.
That's good.
The same thing that applies for salvation, you can speak that same thing or healing or any other crisis in your life.
That's good. That's good. She said, whatever is in your heart in abundance will come out of your mouth. And it's the same principle that you get saved by that you can apply to any other principle of the word of God. Amen. Amen. One more and then we're going to close out. Yes. Yeah. Amen. Amen. The spoken word is the key. And it is true. Speaking the word does change your heart. That's a very key point of revelation right there. Very good. Amen, amen. Let's give God praise. Praise God. Right now, anyone, if you're dealing with any symptom of sickness in your body, this is faith and healing. Amen. And we know the will of God. If you're watching me right now online, the healing power of God is so strong right now because your faith has been built up by the word of God and you're ready to receive. And so if you're dealing with any symptom of sickness, I just want you to lay hands on your body in that area. And right now, Father God, in the name of Jesus, we know your will. Your will for our life is only good. Sickness is darkness. Sickness is from Satan, and it is not your will. Right now, I speak to everyone in this place and under the sound of my voice. I speak to your body now. And in the name of Jesus, I command sickness and infirmity to go, to leave your body now in the name of Jesus. Leave them now in Jesus' name. Holy Ghost, power source, let the power of healing flow into those areas of their bodies right now and bring total healing and restoration now. For by the stripes of Jesus, we were healed. We are healed in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God for healing.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. We're going to worship God with our giving before we leave. If you need an offering envelope, someone will hook you up. Just raise your hand and they'll get one to you. Amen. Giving is a powerful, powerful act of worship. And it is also an act of faith. Yes. Things happen when you give particularly to the kingdom of God and to the work of God. Powerful things take place because God sees what you give as a seed so that his work and will can increase in the earth, and he honors the seed that you sow. You should know that. You should know that God honors the seed that you sow. Never take offering time for granted. Never make it a routine, just a routine action that we do at the end of service. Always see it as spiritual. Everything that we do is spiritual. Amen. And this seed will advance the work of God, and it also will produce and create harvest for your life. It'll come back to you. The Word of God says it will. And if the Word of God says it will, that means it's the will of God for it to come back to you. And Jesus said it come back good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. We have several ways of giving if you're with us in our sanctuary and on or online. If you're here, you can just write a check or whatever, cash. We're part of the Givelify app. If you want to text your offering, they'll go back to the text. You can text your offering. They got a number for me to read because I ain't memorized it. 219-321-1306. 219-321-1306. You can text it. Once you get it set up, it's just real easy. You can just continue to repeat it. We're part of Givelify, so if you have that app downloaded, we have Cash App, EOC, $EOC Church, or you can go to our website, eocchurch.com, and you can sow your seed that way. But it's all to God, all to his kingdom, amen. All for his glory. Yes. Amen. Let's present our offerings to the Lord in our sanctuary. Those of you online, just touch that device that you're giving on. Make this confession. Father, I love you. You love me. I worship and honor you with my tithes and my offering. They represent my best. I offer them to you from my heart. And I pray that this offering advances your kingdom. Thank you, Jesus. You said my offering is seed. You said when I give, it shall be given to me a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. Will this offering, I'm talking to you, offering, you're coming back to my life, a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, give God a clap offering and pray. Praise God. Dan and I thought I saw Minister Janet. I thought I saw her. I don't see her. Okay, Minister Donna. Y'all do me a favor. I know I prayed, but after I dismiss, there may be some folks who want hands laid on them. And would y'all lay hands on them? Do that for me. These folks, amen. I ain't slighting nobody. Y'all with me? Amen. But because the Word of God says it's appropriate for hands to be laid as well. Amen. Father, we just thank you for a great day. Thank you for a life-changing word for us today concerning your will. And thank you for showing us how to do it, how to get your will activated in our life. Father, I'm looking for testimonies from our time together today of how your word worked in their life. And as we leave this place, release your angels to go before those who are with us here in our sanctuary. Provide safe passage as they go to our different destinations. And everyone in this place and under the sound of my voice, I say that you are blessed. You live in the light. In Jesus' name, amen. Love y'all. Amen. Bless you. Praise God. Bless y'all. Amen. Love you.
See you.